Jaspal Singh Sandhu ji and other authorities of the university for providing us opportunity and platform to organize this webinar. I welcome you all in this webinar on biodiversity, bioindicators, monitoring and ecosystem health, organized by Department of Botanical and Environmental Sciences in collaboration with International Union for Conservation of Nature, Commission on Education and Communication. We are celebrating World Environment Day, and this year the theme of World Environment Day is Celebrate Biodiversity. It was established in 1972 during the United Nations Conference on Human Environment held in Stockholm. Since its establishment, World Environment Day has developed into a global platform for raising awareness and inspiring positive changes in the environment. World Environment Day promotes ways to improve the Earth's environment and conservation of its natural sources such as wildlife, forests, wetlands, etc. This day is a symbolic reminder that we are part of nature and we have to take care of it. It is celebrated in more than 143 countries. On this occasion, we have eminent speakers who have dedicated their lives in conserving biodiversity and in understanding of issues related to it. I welcome our keynote speaker and chief guest of this webinar, Dr. Oman V. Oman, former chairman Kerala State Biodiversity Board and presently honorable director of Center for Venom Informatics, University of Kerala, founder secretary of Society for Translational Cancer Research, and the president of the Society for Nutraceuticals and Chronic Diseases. I also welcome Dr. V.P. Unyal, who is working as senior professor and scientist G at Wildlife Institute of India, Dehradun. He will speak on bioindicators for biodiversity, monitoring, and ecosystem health. I welcome Professor Avinash Kaur Nagpal, former dean, faculty of life sciences, Guru Nanak Dev University, Amritsar, former director, Human Resource Development Center, Guru Nanak Dev University. I also welcome all the faculty members of Guru Nanak Dev University and other universities and colleges, research scholars and students from all over India who are attending this webinar to celebrate World Environment Day. Now I request Dr. M.S. Patti, Head Department of Botanical and Environmental Sciences, to formally welcome our speaker and participants. Dr. M.S. Patti, please. Dr. M.S. Patti, please.
I think it's audible to all of you. So thank you, Dr. Rajinder.
Yes, you are audible.
It's audible to them?
Yes, it is. It is. It is. Mulubekaicha.
So it's a great honor for the university as well as for the department to host this webinar. And I welcome all the experts today, you know, all the experts who are delivering their lecture in this 2-hour webinar, 1.5 hour. And on this inaugural part starting, I must say, today is the World Environment Day. And if you look at the United Nations theme, it is time for nature. So I think all of us, we should, you know, look into the minute aspects of nature like air, water, soil, biodiversity, whatever it is. So I think we must read it. For students, I have something to say. All of us, we must read the environmental related issues which are available, which are upcoming, because during this COVID, you know, the things are very different. We are now working on online and all these things. I think we read the Center Pollution Control Board guidelines. We must look into everyday Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. And you regularly visit again, WHO website. You can read articles on related to COVID, air pollution, and other things on Lancet Journal, Nature. You know, very good articles are coming. So I think it's my advice is to all the students and the participants is just best use of this time, because we have plenty of time and we are all home, you know, homebound. So with these words, I welcome the experts. I'm thankful to Dr. Rajinder, Professor Nash Madam, Saroj Madam, also experts are there. And I'm thankful to our Vice Chancellor who really, you know, you can say promoted this culture in in the university that we should go out and interact with the outside member, and this online medium is the best one where we can, you know, all of us are sitting in different places in India, sometimes outside India. So with these words, I'm thankful to Professor Saroj and Dr. Rajinder, who are the coordinators of this webinar. And again, experts are there, Professor Vinash, Professor Renu Bhardwaj, other faculty members. So with these words, I stop over here, and now I hand over the mic to Dr. Rajinder, please. Thank you.
No. It's time to invite our Dr. Oman V. As a keynote speaker. Now, before his keynote address, I would like to introduce him. I feel honored to introduce you, our keynote speaker and chief guest of this webinar, Dr. Oman V. Oman. His research venture over the past 30 years has been focused mainly on the metabolic hormonal regulation in submammalian vertebrates, and has significantly contributed on comparative endocrinology in non-mammalian vertebrates by establishing a somewhat identical pattern in these vertebrates as in homeotherms in the Department of Zoology, University of Kerala, where he started his career as lecturer in 1980. After obtaining his master's and PhD degree from Banaras Hindu University, he continued his academic positions as reader, professor, head, dean faculty of sciences, till he formally retired in 2010. He has had research collaborations with Professor Agarwal of MD Anderson Cancer Center in USA on plant products in the development of drugs for cancer, and published many papers on this topic. In collaboration with Department of Animal Sciences, Bharatiya Darshan University worked on reproductive biology of calcilians, identified a new species, Gagnophis primus, of Caecilian amphibian. As a recognition of his outstanding research contributions in Caecilian taxonomy, molecular taxonomy, scientists from Natural History Museum, London, honored him by naming a Caecilian amphibian species after himself. He has investigated the role of reactive auxin species and the Knox complexes in metamorphosing tadpoles. Over the last 5 years, he has been working on snake venom and natural products and research related to this. And the area has extended to plant-based snake bite antidotes, molecular level taxonomy of snakes, and venom informatics. He has published over 160 research papers, 13 book chapters, 20 GenBank submissions, and several popular science articles. He has guided 27 students for their doctoral degree. He was a former chairman, Kerala State Biodiversity Board, and presently Honorable Director of Center for Venom Informatics, University of Kerala, Founder Secretary of Society for Translational Cancer Research, and the President of the Society of Nutraceutical and Chronic Diseases. So with this brief introduction, I request Dr. Menon, please start his lecture. Dr. Venom, Oman, please.
Organizing this event along with other all over the world. The themes selected for this meeting is biological diversity, biomonitoring, ecosystem health on the World Environment Day. If you recall, the World Environment Day celebrations started way back in the 1970s and continued since then, after the first meeting of world leaders under the UN banner in Stockholm in 1972 on June the 5th. That meeting was attended by the then Prime Minister of our country, Srimati Indira Gandhi, who was also an ardent supporter of environment and nature. So to commemorate the world leaders' commitment to protection of the environment, because as they in the last 20th century, over around the last seven decades before 1970, world witnessed the deterioration in the health of the environment, which we are discussing today. World witnessed the deterioration of the health of the environment. Therefore, they decided that strict measures and regulatory measures be adopted by different countries world over to protect our environment, so that the human health also, because the human health is directly dependent upon the environment health. So they decided that strict measures are adopted by member countries to regulate human activity so that environment health is protected. So India was also a part of the first Stockholm Summit, the Earth Summit, which is called. Then we enacted the Environment Protection Act as early as 1986. In fact, we had the Forest Act since 1927. A healthy environment, a healthy ecosystem should have around 33% of the geographical area as forest. However, in the last several decades, our forest component came down to national average of around 21%. Therefore, all the states are advised to increase the forest cover to the ideal 33%, with against the national average of 21. So again, the ecosystem consists of the biological diversity. Biological diversity is the chain of life from microorganisms to the highly evolved human being. It's a chain of life which is balanced so that life continues and so on. So therefore, in 1992, around 152 world leaders, including India, assembled in Rio de Janeiro in Brazil and gave start to another form of approach to biological diversity conservation as well as environment conservation, which is called Conference of Parties to Convention on Biological Diversity, CBD. The three main mandates of the CBD were conservation of the biological diversity, which in turn reflects on the ecosystem health, monitoring of the biological diversity, sustainable utilization of the biodiversity, and access and benefit sharing, which means those people who commercially exploit the biological resources should pay a percentage of their income towards conservation and people who conserve the biological diversity. So the CBD, which enacted these mandates in 1992, India was also a signatory to the CBD in 1992. Then for the next 10 years, India debated upon these mandates, and in 2002, Indian Parliament enacted the most important Biodiversity Act with three main mandates. They are conservation of the biological diversity, sustainable utilization of the bioresources, and access and benefit sharing. In order to implement these three mandates, we have a structural organization at three, the central level, state level, and at the local self-government level. At the central level, we have the National Biodiversity Authority. At the state level, we have State Biodiversity Board. And at the local level, we have Biodiversity Management Committees. So this three-level biological diversity conservation, which in turn reflects or protects the biohealth also, is present in all the Indian states, including Punjab. Punjab state also has a biodiversity board, which constituted biodiversity management committees at the local self-government level in all the local self-governments of the Punjab. So we have a well-structured machinery mechanism already made, but in order to make it more functional and to make the capacity building of the BMCs, the state biodiversity boards and the National Biodiversity Authority should continuously strengthen the capacity of the biodiversity boards. So the uses of the biodiversity in general are, as you mentioned earlier, air, water, and food, which are the most important ingredients or necessities of life to sustain on the planet and life to continue. So biological diversity provides good air, water, and food. And all these three will be available only if the ecosystem health is protected. And therefore, we have to continuously monitor the biological diversity, for which we have a biodiversity management committee at the local level. The first mandate of the biodiversity management committee is to document the biodiversity locally and make it in the form of a document called People's Biodiversity Register. I'm very happy to say that Kerala State Biodiversity Board constituted biodiversity management committees or BMCs in all the local self-governments in the state and documented the biological diversity in the form of PBR and People's Biodiversity Register. It is a register made by the people, for the people, and of the people. So therefore, I am very happy to say that Punjab also has a fairly good dynamic biodiversity board, which has constituted BMCs in I do not know which, all the local self-governments, at least most of them. So the biological diversity, as I mentioned earlier, helps in sustaining healthy life on the planet. So the healthy life of human beings and all other organisms, as I mentioned earlier, biodiversity is the chain of life from microorganisms to the highly evolved human beings. So if that balance tilts for some reason, it will create ripples in the chain of life. In fact, we are at present witnessing that kind of a catastrophe with the emergence of novel coronavirus 2, which causes the COVID-19 disease all over the world. No country in the world is accepted. And that again caused because of human wildlife conflict, and we conquered into their territory, and that resulted, and we are paying the price for that. But then every crisis has got an opportunity also. The nature made this crisis into an opportunity of cleansing the environment. I was very happy to learn that you could see Himalayas from Jalandhar, which has got about 252 kilometers, giving proof that the air quality has improved tremendously, for the first time in the last century, probably. In fact, I could see Himalayas only when I reached Manali, which is only a few kilometers away. You could see Himalayas from Jalandhar city on top of some high-rise buildings, the Himalayas. So that adequately proves. Again, Delhi used to be one of the most polluted cities in the world. Now the pollution control boards, we have the pollution control boards to monitor the air quality of the states, which is a statutory body, which regularly monitors the air quality and informs the citizen of the need to use protective gears. Even before corona coming, people in Delhi were forced to use masks. So therefore, the biological diversity, the sustainable utilization of bioresources alone will sustain the biological diversity for the future generations. In fact, the sustainability and the was our mandate in our country. Our father of our nation, Mahatma Gandhi, used to say that nature gives everything for your need, but not for your greed. Do not exploit natural resources for your greed. Nature will give everything for your need. You can avail everything from nature for your need, but not for your greed. Therefore, we should be mindful about protecting the environment. Even though we have statutory bodies like National Biodiversity Authority, State Biodiversity Board, State Pollution Control Board, it depends upon each citizen of the country to change their lifestyle towards conservation of the biological diversity and protection of the environment. So therefore, we must be very thankful to the nature and the ecosystem for the ecosystem services they render to sustain life on this planet. So we seldom remember about the value of the ecosystem services. Now, amidst the COVID-19, we realize the importance of ecosystem services. For example, I happened to see on the TV 2 months ago that an old gentleman, 85-year-old gentleman, was discharged from a hospital in Italy. And when he was given the bill, it was shown that he was charged $3,000 for 1 day for oxygen in the ventilator. He started crying. So the hospital, he told them, "I'm not crying because you charged $3,000 for me for a day, but I'm crying, I'm 85 years old, that how many crores or millions of dollars the nature would have spent to sustain my life on this planet." The estimate today is that a human being requires oxygen worth 1.72 crores rupees a year and 1 lakh rupee for water for a year. So you can imagine the ecosystem services or the economics of the ecosystem and biodiversity, that's a branch emerging now called TEEB, the economics of ecosystem and biodiversity. So how much the nature is investing on its organisms, including us, to sustain life on this planet. So therefore, this disaster is as a result of an imbalance in that chain of life. So we must now adopt measures to correct that. In fact, Winston Churchill said, "You must make use of every crisis into an opportunity." So this crisis, which now faces humanity due to the deterioration of the ecosystem health, due to the deterioration of the biological diversity, should be addressed in the scientific manner. In fact, science and technology alone can build a nation, including its economic development. But if it goes to the wrong hand, it is a double-edged sword, actually. If it goes to the wrong hand, it can create havoc. And the same science and technology will bring you eternal peace, will bring you light, will bring you coolness, and the same nuclear power can create havoc on the earth, as we have witnessed in the Second World War. So therefore, every citizen of the country is expected to abide the Biological Diversity Act and the biological diversity rules framed by each state so that the ecosystem health is maintained. In fact, the Biodiversity Act envisages monitoring of the biological diversity constantly through and documenting it as the PBR, as I mentioned earlier. So the preparation of the PBR, which is a local biodiversity register, now the National Green Tribunal has made it a legal document so that, and asked all the biodiversity management committees to make the biodiversity registers mandatory and report it to the National Green Tribunal. In fact, it was supposed to be reported before 31st of March 2020. Unfortunately, again, this COVID-19 hindered the activity of that project. So it is going on. So therefore, any imbalance in the ecosystem health will reflect upon the health of its organisms. Biological Diversity Act and Environment Act and Forest Act, all these acts are expected to maintain the green cover of the country, which provides us with natural green, pure air, good water. And if you, when you pollute our water system, water bodies, in fact, in the last 100 years, due to mechanization of agriculture and our need for amassing great wealth, our greed for amassing great wealth, our ecosystem health has deteriorated. So therefore now measures based on science and technology to alleviate the human miseries, science and technology for human welfare. So let's now, in order to tide over the present crisis of which is probably very soon. So therefore, let's all commit ourselves towards making a new world, a new normal after the coronavirus. In fact, the disease has taught us a lesson, a new normal situation world over. We have to change our lifestyle. So that our need are regulated, restricted, and our environment is protected. Ecosystem health is improved through constant monitoring of the ecosystem. So, in fact, India is one of the 17 mega diverse countries in the world. We have 4 biodiversity hotspots: the Himalayas, the Eastern Ghats, the Western Ghats, Eastern Ghats, and Andaman Nicobar Islands. So, we have about two percent of the world's geographical area, but 7% of the world's biodiversity. In fact, the around 5 billion year old Amazon forest is considered to be the planet of Earth, while our greenness, our Western Ghats, our Himalayas, our Andaman Nicobar Islands, they are considered to be the health or the lungs of the India, lungs of our country. So if the lung collapses, life is lost. Therefore, we have to protect it legally and mandatorily. Environmental protection and conservation is ensured so that life continues. We have not inherited this planet from our grandchildren. It's our responsibility to give it back to them, protected, maintained, healthy, and give it back to them so that life continues. So Biological Diversity Act envisages the biodiversity conservation at the local level, which is the foundation for the biological diversity conservation. So I'm very happy that Punjab state is doing a wonderful job in conserving biological diversity. And in fact, there was a few days ago, there was an International Day of Biodiversity, which was celebrated by Pushpa Gujral Science City. I have a colleague there, who was responsible for organizing the International Day for Biological Diversity, which was on May the 22nd. So all these days, let our celebrations be not confined to that one particular day. We should live every day as World Environment Day or Biological Diversity Day. Make changes in our day-to-day life so that our air is purified, our water is pure, our food which we eat is pure. Unfortunately, we adopted to mechanization and large-scale farming, which is again a curse in Punjab, I'm sure. So we have to gradually turn to improve the health of our ecosystem, particularly the health of the soil ecosystem, so that good agricultural practices are taken in, and so that the health of the soil returns to somewhat normal. If not organic farming, let us adopt good agricultural practices. Let us conserve all the biological diversity, because the oxygen which we breathe comes from the trees around around us. Around 60% of the oxygen come from the trees and 40% to come from the water bodies around us. Therefore, it is essential that we maintain the greenery on the terrestrial land, and we keep the water pure so that we get the life or the oxygen from them around. Not only oxygen, the trees assimilate the carbon dioxide, which we give out as waste gas. They take in that carbon dioxide graciously and assimilate it and make it into carbohydrate, again give us as food. Therefore, what an interaction between man and animals, or animals and plants. So therefore, we maintain that balance so that ecosystem health is maintained, and which is again continuously monitored through bio-monitoring processes, about which Dr. Unnial will be talking in detail. I'm very happy that Guru Nanak University has organized this event on this auspicious day, particularly in the context of a global catastrophe which we are facing. We have to tide over this situation and make the world, the new world, a new world order, a new normal post-COVID situation, wherein we live in harmony with nature. We live in love with nature. Only we can love the nature when we know that what we have. That is what we do by bio-monitoring or documenting the biological diversity around us as in the form of people's biodiversity register, which is considered to be a legal document when it comes to biodiversity exploration, so that our environment, we know what we have and we can conserve what we have. So eventually, science and technology should be utilized for human welfare, and human welfare can only be ensured through a healthy ecosystem, healthy environment, and abundant biological diversity. So I wish all of you the very best in this International Environment Day. Let us celebrate it every day in our life by regulating or adjusting our life in tune with a happy environment, peaceful environment, and healthy environment. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Professor Omanji. Now we have our next speaker, Dr. V.P. Unnial. Regarding his brief introduction, Dr. V.P. Unnial is working as a senior professor and scientist G at Wildlife Institute of India, Dehradun. He has been involved in research projects on biodiversity monitoring through bioindicators in the Indian Himalayan region. He has completed more than 25 research projects and supervised 20 PhD students on different aspects of biodiversity monitoring. He is the fellow of Royal Entomological Society, London, and he has attended various international conferences on insects conservation, ecology, and monitoring. He has more than 100 international and national research papers and 4 books in his research credit. He has traveled entire Indian Trans and Western Himalayan region, including Kailash Mansarovar region of China, during his research exploration. So I invite Dr. V.P. Unnial to share his views on the topic. Dr. Unnial, please. Dr. Unnial, please. Dr. Unnial, please.
Ma'am, he is not audible.
Dr. Unnial, you are not audible, please. Hello, Dr. Unnial.
He is unmuted, but there is some audio problem from his side, I think. Maybe if you can, sir, you can, if you try removing the earphones and then try, I'm not sure, maybe that will help. No, still not audible, sir.
Hello, I'm audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, you are audible, sir.
Okay, fine, fine. Okay. The slides are clear in my screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Okay. Good morning, everyone, and good afternoon. And thank you very much, the organization, for inviting me for this wonderful discussion on World Environment Day. And as Madam already discussed, and we define about myself, I am working on bioindicators. I will discuss here what is the bioindicators, what is the use of bioindicators, and today is World Environment Day. I will discuss about their importance, how we will monitor those things also. And first of things, I want one question in the minds of everyone: how you will monitor the ecosystem health? This is the ecosystem health. As a human being, we are just going to our physician to monitor our health. And what physician is doing? Physician is just first going your temperature, your blood pressure, your ECG. On the basis of those indicators, physician is saying your health is fine. But as an environmentalist, as a biologist, as a person doing with biodiversity, how you will monitor the health of ecosystem? So you are a physician of the environment. So how will monitor those? Your village around is fine, your forest is fine, your national park and sanctuaries are fine. How will monitor it? We need certain indicators like physician. So I will discuss here how you will select those indicators and how those indicators will help you for monitoring of biodiversity. So since I'm working here in Wildlife Institute of India, and people are thinking that only tiger, rhino, elephant, and this species are the flagship species, on the basis of their presence and absence, you can say your forest is rich, but not at all. We are having beautiful tiger beetle. We are having beautiful tiger butterflies. We are having tiger moth. On the basis of those beautiful small creature, you can monitor the health of that ecosystem. So we need their presence. Just remember this ecosystem health. This in the system, in the forest, in the ecosystem, everything, plants, fungi, birds, gastropods, echinoderms, fishes, planktons, sponges, annelids, spiders, it's ecosystem. But the focus is different. If you are ornithologist or you are expert of birds, you are saying you are just going and just observing on a bird species. You are least both of a spider. If a plant taxonomist is going in the field and just he is just observing how many plant species and what is the status of those plants, he is forgetting about annelids. But spiders are equally important than your annelids, than your tiger, than your rhino, elephant, and other species. Even then, you can know it. The total worldwide population species of the spider is 44,000 species. Difficult to identify, difficult to remember the names. Our country is having 1,004 species. Even in Kerala is a state in Sacred Heart College, Kochi. I just 2 hours ago, I was in the other meeting with Kerala's department, zoology department of Sacred Heart College. I given lecture on that also. The Dr. Sebastian and team of their work in the spiders of Western Ghat, the spiders of Kerala, and a fantastic book on spiders. What is the importance of spider? But nobody's understanding. Our focus is different, but can you know that? How many species of annelids in nearby your forest area? How many number of annelids species in your Amritsar University campus? Nobody knows it, but this is playing a very important role. If the earthworms is not in the soil, we'll enhance the fertility of the soil. So the equally that every component is important, and those components called as a bioindicators, like this particular insect, odonata. If you are going to the forest area, you are able to see the odonates nearby area, you will get the water body certainly. It means it is indicator of water body. So in ecosystem, every component is equally important in that way. They exist each other. They coexist each other. And they then give the ecosystem health. They are an indicator of our physician. Our physician's indicator to monitor your health is temperature, blood pressure, ECG, your sugar test, and further investigation. Our ecosystem health is every component. A spider, birds, fishes, dragonflies, butterflies, snakes, if the component is not available in the surroundings, in your forest, it means the health of that ecosystem is not perfect. So this is the bioindicators. Dr. Oman already discussed about that way our country is having rich in biodiversity. We are having large number of angiosperm plants, fishes, reptiles, birds, and mammal species. Richest in diversity we are having. And do you know the Western Ghat? Richest in the hottest part of the countries of the biodiversity. And out of that, you can see the tiger. So 70% of the tigers, even 60% of Asian elephants, they're from India. Nearly 80% of the horned rhino, some other species rich in diversity here. And then we are having the biogeographical zones of the country. How you will differentiate it? The species we are going to observe in Ladakh, Trans-Himalaya, is not available in Western Ghat. The species in desert area of Thar and Rajasthan and Gujarat, not in Arunachal and the part of the Northeast Himalayas. So the biogeographical zone has been classified on the basis of habitat of particular species. There's no state boundaries. 10 biogeographical zone. And the presence of the species exists on different area, their habitat, this classification has been discussed. This has been developed for this biogeographical zones. You know these pictures from your childhood, from your school days. But everything is important. Within the ecosystem, the highest percentage of insect, and they are connecting link between each other. Because majority of the insect, amphibians are dependent on birds, insectivorous birds, the spiders, and other group of animals. They feed on insect. It means insect is a very, very important component for biodiversity, connecting links and food chain. And ultimately, those insects are helping for our pollination cycle. I will discuss the issue of pollination separately. Within the whole limit of the diversity, insect is having the highest number. If you go for the higher plants or the animals, bacteria, and algae, viruses also, but they are playing very important role. And they are mostly 90% of the animal kingdom. And the subject, the person knows it is called entomology, dealing the person working on the science of entomology. Is entomologist, and his major role is to study the ecology, behavior, anatomy, physiology, biochemistry, genetics. He can then read then this small fly, Drosophila. Majority of the genetic studies on Drosophila is important. So the small fly is important. Within that insect, the largest group is the beetle. And why the beetles is important, and why the fascinating beetles you can see here. That all outer part of the beetles, this part is called elytra, and those elytra is having so metallic shining, people are collecting it and making artificial jewelry out of it. Even then, see the color combinations. For this color point, color combinations, people is collecting it and doing the trade off with it. But then insects is an ancient group of animals, and they are exceeding more than 90% of the animal kingdom. And so they have been reported from, Mount Everest region, Antarctic regions, deserts, and some of the insect is larger than this, is larger than some of the mammals also. You know about how the insect has been classified that way, but the number of species is very high, and 53 of all named species are insect, that large group. And they're having 30 different orders and many keystone species, orders in different group of insect. And this large group is the six-legged animals is the largest group of animal kingdoms, which I'll discuss here. Total number of species of insects from the world exceed 1.5 million, representing 90% of the animal kingdom. Yeah. They belong to the vast group of arthropods, and old as dinosaur roamed on the earth. They are this living on the earth several million years ago before man. But who has done the insect study, who's started in India? This first, in 1909, Lefroy started working on diversity of insect and this documentation, and documented about 25,000 odd species. Subsequently, large number of scientists working on insect diversity. And so I want to highlight here the name of Professor Runwal. Major Runwal, and subsequently joined Forest Research Institute to work as entomologist, and started working on termites. He's the father of Indian termite. I will tell you the story how the termite is important. Termite is equally important than the tiger in the forest. If in forest area there's no termite, the health of that forest is not good. Termite is one of the best indicator to monitor the health of the forest ecosystem. Subsequently, other group of scientists from Zoological Survey of India, they have documented the diversity of insect here. We are having this Wildlife Protection Act. And within Wildlife Protection Act, we're having different schedules. Schedules means category of animals, like tiger, schedule one, rhino, elephant, other species. Schedule one means if you do any disturbance with the habitat of that animal, can disappear anytime. But we are having 128 species of butterfly also in schedule one. Means those butterflies so important than tiger, equally important than tiger, equally important than the elephants. So why the trade-off the butterflies? Why people is collecting those small beautiful creatures for decoration purpose? Textile industries have collected for designing of textile industry. Even then this trade, I've already discussed about the trade of beetles. Majority of the beetles having this beautiful like metallic color combination. You are having the two horn rhino or for this color combinations, people is collecting it. But ultimately is a they are the essential component for an ecosystem. In our forest area, in your kitchen garden, in your agricultural land, this decomposition process is not going to complete without insect, without indicators. The pollination cycle and dispersal of seed is not going to complete without insect. They are maintaining this plant community composition structures via phytophagy, including seed of feedings. Food of many insectivorous vertebrates, including birds, mammals, reptiles, and fish, they depend on insect. Maintaining of animal community structure through transmission of the disease of large animals and predations and parasitism of small one. But plant-insect interaction that affects nutrient cycling, which I already discussed. Without presence of insect, the nutrient cycle process is not going to complete it. Direct change of carbon storage, mutualisms, pollination, and seed dispersal. They are the best ecosystem engineers, microbial feeders, dispersal agent of so many organisms. And here you can see this spider, there's a termite. If the termite is attacked inside your house, it will damage your articles, certainly. But is the termite in the nature, in the forest, they will enhance the fertility of the soil. You can see this mound is 2 meters high and 2 meters deep inside of the soil. It's completely 4 meters, more than that. If you're going to go and cut it from the top, you will see the 4 meter is complete air conditioned chamber. The percolation of the water, the aeration is so perfect, it is enhancing the soil fertility. If any tree is very close to the termite mound, it is not going to harm it. Termite is very important. They are a landscape architect. And you can see these pictures here, how the termite is helpful for percolation of water perfectly. We are having 2,600 species worldwide, 281 genera, and about 253 species and 54 genera is Indian continent. How the termite is important, I already discussed that way. Professor Runwal, he is the father of Indian termite who started working on termites. But currently, the best of my knowledge, only few persons in the country working on termites. Nobody is going to ready to touch the termites. But in the forest area, for the biodiversity point of view, they are very, very important and essential component of biodiversity. I will discuss that way, how this how the ants is important, you see. Without presence of ants, this decomposition, leaf decomposition is not going to perfect. You might have seen it. Everybody has seen it, how the time, because ants is moving in the forest, long line, going deep into the soil. They're making about 2-3 meter deep tunnel inside of the soil. And during monsoon, the percolation of the water is very, very perfect in the soil. So this is the importance of the termites in biodiversity point of view. Very, very important for the cyclics. The study of the social insect, Hymenoptera, bees, ants, their understanding, their studies to understand the evolution of interaction of behavior and their social biological own existence of entomology study. several theoretical ideas of ecology from the inset. Holistic concept of ecology, ecosystem, and niches came from the freshwater system in which insects are dominant. Even Charles Darwin, of his theory of evolution by natural selection, deduced his thesis based on his tropical entomological observation, how the insect is important for biodiversity. But the number of insects means that they are important upon the environment and hence our life is highly significant. They are the major component of microscopy, biodiversity. And if only for this reason, we should understand them better. But question is here, how many insects are there? How many kind of insects are available? What is the total number of insects, species in the world? The honest answer is nobody knows exactly, because the group is very, very vast, 30 different orders. But the number of kind of species is so great that entomologists can't keep an accurate count except of small groups. They are predominant biota of all continents, estimating figures roughly this 6 lakhs to 1 million species. Large percentage is yet to be discovered and reported. The biology student knows about the phylum Arthropoda. The phylum Arthropoda is divided into 4 classes: crustaceans, myriapoda, centipedes, insecta, and arachnids, spiders. Within insecta class, insecta is again divided into 4 subclasses. And 4 subclasses, those classes again divided into 29 to 30 different orders. Orders means group of insects, like Lepidoptera. The orders, butterflies and moth. Coleoptera, beetles. Diptera, flies. Hymenoptera, bees. Hemiptera, bugs. Thysanoptera, those orders is so big. Then they again divided into the family, then genera and then species. Difficult to study all insect group. That's why the information of insect is very, very limited. And the students and any scientists working in entomology is very, very limited. Again here, what is the use of the insect here? How the insect is useful for our ecosystem? If any tree, whether it's a sal, devdar tree, neem tree, any big tree, the life of this tree is like roughly 200 to 300 years. Within 200 and 300 years, variety of insect is feeding on the tree. Some insect feeding on flowers, some is on leaf, some is on wood, some is on bark, some of go inside of the soil. Means variety of insect group is feeding on the tree when the tree is standing for 200 to 300 and more than that, the ecosystem and existence of insect. When the tree is dying, it again requires more than 200 years to decompose properly with the help of insects. First group of insect will come and debark it. And that is Scolopteridae family, small mining beetle. They make minings on the bark of the tree. If you go and remove the bark of the tree, you will see very fine minings, linings over the tree. Family Scolopteridae. Then different group of insect will come. And then subsequently, large number of insect will come and decompose it with the help of this ecosystem. And amphibians, birds, other group of animals will come and depend on this caterpillar, larvae, and insect. So this is the combination, this is the ecosystem. In the Himalayas, since last more than 20 years, I'm observing one tree in Kedarnath Wildlife Sanctuary. This is the oak tree, very hardwood. And this hardwood tree, oak tree, I'm observing one species of insect who is helping in the decomposition process. He has this pitfall traps and light trap we are using in every year. And I'm just monitoring this tree last 20 years in one place. I'm having the complete picture of 20 years pictures of the tree. But which I'm observing, the decomposition process is very, very slow. It will require still 20 to 30 years to decompose properly with the help of those insects. And you can understand how the insect is important. We have put a small weather recording system over there. It is 3,000 meter altitude in Himalayas in Kedarnath Wildlife Sanctuary of Uttarakhand. My idea is here to monitor this system, how this important is to my small creature is important for biodiversity monitoring. If you have, you might have seen it in your village around in forest area. If there's dung, you will see the dung beetle. It means the health of that ecosystem is rich. If you are visiting in the forest and you have seen the dungs of animal, wildlife, dung of wildlife, but if there's no any dung beetle on this dung piles, it means the health of that ecosystem is not good. The dung beetle is an indicator for good soil structure. We require dung beetle. It's helping us. It's providing us ecosystem service. It's rolling the dung and putting inside of the soil, enhancing the soil fertility. So this is the ecosystem service providers. So it is an indicator. If dung is there, no dung beetle, the health of that is not good. Some of the insect orders, how it looks like, which is the largest number of animal species in different orders. And where are their distribution? Indian peninsulas, Malaysia, China, Plateau region, is the richest area for this insect studies. Evergreen forests of Eastern Himalayas. Even in Western Ghats, Nilgiri, Annamalai, they are richest in, and Himalayas, certainly in Jammu and Kashmir, Uttarakhand, and Himachal Pradesh is the richest in the point of view of the different insect orders. But monitoring of biodiversity through use of indicators, bioindicators is the umbrella group of biodiversity conservation. Developing area, why you do the study of insect for monitoring of biodiversity, for developing area specific management plan and guidelines for the biodiversity. Information of insect fauna is little export. We are having the list of butterflies of different protected areas of the country. Currently, our country is having more than 700 national parks and sanctuaries, 700 protected areas. We are having certain information of butterflies of some protected areas, but not we are having the information of pollinators of any protected area. We are now not having the information of grasshoppers of any protected areas. The information of insect fauna is very, very little export. They are in the endemicity of Wildlife Protection Act status is not very clearly known. Only butterflies documented, and still the large group is divided. Again, here, though, what is the use of those indicators? Those indicators is basically for the environment. Within environment, how you will monitor the water quality, natural water quality, on the presence of benthic fauna, small creature on water. If the creature is not available, the quality of water is a little different. Soil structure, nematodes, soil nematodes and other insect, ears, species, and those resources is ultimately for our ecosystem health. And ultimately, the use of those indicators for human, our society, for human beings, for our managers to monitor and write management plans for conservation issues, government and industries, peoples. Yeah. So some of the things, how the indicators, I already discussed here, what are the indicators, how they look like, but what they do, the presence of absence of those indicators, they provide us the responses. Long-term and short-term responses. If suppose you are visiting your village, you are visiting very frequently one particular patch of the forest, and you are observing it, particular insect, particular bird, particular animal, which you are observing in a couple of years, but in recent past, it is disappearing. If it is disappearing, they are giving you the responses. Something is wrong. So those indicators give you the long ecological relevance, and gives the responses, whether it's their presence and absence will help. And ultimately, those responses will go for the sensitive of early warning of climate change. Now, everybody is saying that climate change. If there's hot, very heavy snowfall, the people are saying there's climate change. This temperature is rising very high, saying the climate change. Monsoon is very heavy, they're saying the climate change. But how will monitor this climate change? With help of those indicators, and those indicators will give you the warning what is going on. Their presence and absence will warn you. You can say those bioindicators, say we can, if you are monitoring for the environment, can we talk as environmental indicators? Ecological parts, we can say ecological indicators, similar things, but this criteria is slightly different to monitor it. Subsequently, I just want to highlight here, this is the plant, it's called Urtica dioica of Himalayas, Bichubuti. In this particular dioica in monsoon season, one particular species of butterfly, this is the red admiral and painted lady. Both the species, they feed on this plant. If the plant will disappear, the life cycle of this butterfly will disappear. It is a coexistence, host plant, ecological balance. So this is the ultimately for ecosystem health and biodiversity monitoring. Some of the functional and ecological ultimately give you the ecological health and function on this particular aspect. Ecological health certainly for this climatic and food stability of the mans. They can say bioindicators, biomarkers, and ecological assessment risk on you. But how will you select those indicators? The question is very, very important here. I already discussed the physician, your physician is having certain indicators, that is established indicator. The temperature, blood pressure, sugar, testing of sugar of human being, the indicator. But the monitoring of ecosystem, selection of indicator is slightly ticklish and difficult. It requires very long research and observation. On the basis of those observations, you can provide those indicators, you can select those, can provide you the warning implementation of environmental damage, can indicate environmental remedies, important link, stretches of ecological relevance effect, and this incorporated ecological assessment. Maybe you can, those indicators will be known as a taxonomically well-known, biology and livelihood histories well understood, habitat and highly differentiated, occurrence over the plot, the geographical ranges, common and easy, find salt, terrestrial ecosystems, many insect orders and families can become this good indicators for this monitoring. And this monitoring and inventing studies require research, at least 4, 5, 10, 20 years research. On the basis of those research, you can select this is the best indicator to monitor the health of ecosystem by their presence or nothingness. And ultimately, the abundance of the species. If you are monitoring and selecting any indicators, the abundance is not high, it can't become a good indicator. On the basis of the species richness, their occurrence, and ultimately, what the important is the functional and natural ecosystem is the rule. If you are selecting any indicators, can become good for this ecosystem health procedures. Large number of scientists identified different groups for this bioindicators. This thing suggested that the Hymenoptera bees is a good indicator and diptera flies is a good indicator. Certainly, bees are good indicators. If you are observing one fruiting plant in your kitchen garden or in your village surround and close to your forest, and a couple of years you're observing that the plant is flowering perfectly, but there's no fruit. If you're observing that last few years, there's no fruiting on the plant. Fruits, flowers are very rich. It means something is wrong with the plant. The health of that plant is not good. The health of the surrounding area is not good. Means there's a lack of pollinators. They all pollinators disappear. That's not helping the pollination of the plant species. Maybe use of pesticide, use of fertilizers, they're killing the pollinating species. So this type of observation is required to select any indicator species. Murphy and Wilcox suggested that butterfly is a good indicator, certainly. Early in the morning, weather is very fine, you are coming in the office, your college, your village, you are able to see the butterflies are flying. But certainly, heavy rain, storm, they all disappear. They are the litmus test of our environment. So this can become indicators. If you're not observing any butterfly in a couple of years and a couple of months from your in your campus, it means something is wrong. So this type of observation can help you to select indicators. Again, butterflies and dragonflies are suggested. And in PSN Kasola, they use that tiger beetle as a good indicator. And what is the tiger beetles? What the tiger beetles look like, I will tell you here. The tiger beetles, we're having 280 species in India, 180 species to the endemic to India, and roughly 2,080 species documented worldwide. And tiger beetle look like this. This is the elytra, it's metallic shining. People are collecting it, making artificial jewelry for this elytra. Because if you are having any gold and silver, you require polishing. But if you are having this metallic shinings after 100 years, there's no dilution of the shining of this metallic part of this insect. So this is the, that's why this beetles, this type of beetles has been treated. But here, yeah, you can see this tiger beetle. We have done a study of tiger beetles, but how the tiger beetles look like and what the use of this tiger beetle, you can just understand it and enjoy. So this is the beauty of the stagger beetle. That's why the stagger beetle has been designated as a best indicator for monitoring of biodiversity. But I'm not saying that only tiger beetle is the indicator. You can select any indicators in your area. In our country is vast. We're having this, you can say Ladakh area, Trans Himalaya, Hamis National Park is cold desert. We are having Valley of Flowers, high altitude area. We are having Kalakad Mundan Three Tiger Reserves in Tamil Nadu, Andaman Nicobars. The indicators of different areas is different. If any species exists in Himalaya, in Valley of Flowers, it's not possible. The same species you find in Kalakad Mundan Three Tiger Reserves of Tamil Nadu. The indicators of high altitude area, Valley of Flowers, Nanda Devi, Kedarnath, and Great Wildlife Park of Himachal is different, other areas is different. Selection of the indicators on the basis of your research, your observation, and they can help for the ecosystem monitoring. But we have, how we have done it? We have done with the simplest exercise with the forest department, because we are dealing with the forest, different forest areas, and we have developed small designing. Even then some of the students can do it and monitor in your campus, your village, and some other agricultural fields. We have designed a small forms, given the name and the latitude, longitude, date, and where the person is going, and some of the pictures of that area, of insect monitoring, some of the format for the plant monitoring, some of the format for this bird monitoring. And this picture we have handed over to the forest department for this forest guard. When the forest guard is visiting any particular area, he is monitoring. If you have observed any butterfly, what is the color of the butterfly? Which type, location, habitat? If you have seen some ants, number of ants and color of ants, size of ants, you can take the pictures. And he can, after completing his field visit, he can deposit in his office. Next month, if he's again going in the same area, he can use it. Then next year, same month, he can use it. On the basis of the observation of 2, 3 years or 5 years, you can select the indicators. In particular area, suppose location A, the forest guard has observed this butterfly since last 5 years. It means the habitat, the host plant, and other ecosystem, this butterfly is favorable. So this butterfly can become the indicator of that particular area to monitor. Maybe same in the case of birds, same in the case of animals, same in the case of plants. So this is a small exercise to select indicator species. Yes, I want to request your master's student, graduate students, you can do this exercise to monitor any species of your campus. Your university campus is beautiful. Goodest greenery over there, the agriculture fields is there, the small forest, bottle gardens is there. You can use those things and monitor indicator species. But it's required very regular monitoring. If you have monitor in your botanical garden of Guru Nanak Dev University regularly, particular butterfly or particular ants, and you are having the observation and information of last 10 years. After 10 years, if any person will come and observe in the same location, then he can say that the ants and this particular butterfly, this particular animal, this particular bird is not available today. They will give you the warning. Means then can warn you your ecosystem is declining. On the basis of those observations, you can monitor, you can select those beautiful indicators. Ultimately, is one species on this way is termites, former city family. Currently, only our country, only 1 and 2% working on termites. Sorry, ants. You already seen the beauty of the ants. And the ants is very, very good ecosystem engineers. They are keystone species. They are nutrient cyclists. Without ants, your decomposition process is not going to complete. High biomass and activity levels make ants especially valuable. Predators of pest of ants, farms, harvest ants, weaver ants. And ants is important here. We have done some study of ants in our campus. And Punjabi University, Patiala, Dr. Bharti is working on ants. He's all expert of ants of the country. I have 1 and 2% in South India, they're working on ants. This is not. But ants is very, very important. If you are going in your village around in forest, if there's no ants on the tree, you know, ants on the plant, the health of that ecosystem is not good. They are the best ecosystem health indicators. So this type of indicators, this type of observation, you can monitor the ecosystem. You can see that how the ants is helping for our soil structure, which is fault and indicators. Now is pollination. You know about the pollination. What is the definition of pollination? I don't want to highlight here. But how the pollinators are important. They are keystone service providers. Maintaining wild plant communities. They are mostly bees is necessary for this production of 80% of the crops and 70% of the crops used for this human food worldwide. They are good for the tea. Bees are good for the tea and tea are good for the bees. And Einstein was saying that long back. If the bees disappear off the surface of the globe, then man would only have 4 years of life left. No more bees, no more pollinators, no more plants, and no more animals. Bees, pollinators is important here. And the role of this flowers is very important for the pollination attractions, the fragrance of the flowers. But the nectar is in pollen, even the sugar in nectars and amino acids, toxins, and various of pollinations. The flowers color is important here. We are having low lakhs pollinations on the Hymenoptera bees come in this order, having 120,000 known species and 20,000 species of bees. These are some of the important families of bees. And other group of insects is the butterflies and moths, the wood pollinators, the beetles, apart from that way. Even you can see how this particular species of pollinators is helping one particular plant. It not means that majority of the bees will pollinate all the crops. So this is the behavior of pollinators. Pollinators is not going to, all pollinators will not go into all cropping system. Specific pollinators on the basis of colors and this fragrance and amino acids and pollen grains. But they are declining very fast. And this one of the cause of decline is the mobile towers. This is a study done in Kerala. The bees, the electromagnetic radiations you know about, they produce from the mobile towers, and those radiations is disrupting this behaviors of bees. And when the bees is going out, the worker bees is going out, they're not coming back because of their navigation behavior has been disrupted by this electromagnetic radiations of these mobile towers. So this is one of the cause of decline of pollinators. You know about it, how we can't get honey without honeybees. They are important components. Large number of publications and people are very serious about this attack on bees on all fronts. But you can see here, this video, how the flower colors, how the fragrance, how the wind velocity, how the structure of the flowers is important for the bees. Every component is important. The fragrance, the flowers, colors, stigma, that we, it's not one pollinator will come and pollinate the flower system. So everything is important here. But what is happening in how the cause of decline in Himalayas? In Himachal Pradesh, Uttarakhand, and apple growing states like Jammu and Kashmir, people start just in winter season, they are pruning their fruiting plant and putting the paste of this pesticide of the 2 meter tree trunk, where any insect will sit here will die. Whether it's a pollinator, or the butterfly, and any animal, any insect. And when the fruit is ready, again, they are doing for this pesticide spray. They're putting and they're killing those pollinators. But what is happening now? If you're able to visit the areas again, you go, in every apple tree, there's one bottle hanging. Within the bottle, there's pheromones. That pheromones for the attraction of pollinator, because they kill all the pollinators here. There's no pollinator exists here. Very limited pollinators to collect and for this pollinator attraction, they are using pheromones. So this is the cause of decline of pollinators. But we are using National Pollinator Week in next week, June 22nd, to sensitize common man about the decline of pollinators, use of native plants, hummingbird feeders, bee house, and butterfly garden. The insect, you know, how they change the colors for this defense mechanism. They are mimicry babies also. And there's communication skills, their bioluminescence and social behavior. And they migrate, they diapause, they hibernate, with good for the human food. Even then, last week, this desert locust, large number of locusts from Pakistan to attack in near Rajasthan and some part of Madhya Pradesh area. Good food for the animal, good food for the birds. Even then, people are using it. There are some videos that in Pakistan, they are selling in the market and they are earning money out of it. But they attack our plant. So one of the topics. But you can't get honey without honeybee. You can't get silk without silk moth. So that is equally important if they are harming for nature. But ultimately, we're having good indicator, group of insects, butterflies, 1,500 species. They are a category. In which category, in schedule of the insects here. I've done a study on butterflies of high altitude areas, Gangotri, origin of River Ganges here, Gomuk area. And there are some animals and pheasants. This is state bird of Himachal, Uttarakhand, Monal, and Western Tagapan, the species of Himachal Pradesh. They are also feeding on insects. There's the habitat of this bird species at 2,500 meter altitude in Himalayas. But they're making and they're feeding on insects. They're feeding on ants. They're feeding on caterpillars. So how the ecosystem is exist here? This is a beautiful bird of the bird community called as Western Tagapan. They're mainly feeding on insects. So how the insect is important. The species can become the indicator. If the species is available over there, it means the food is sufficient. And within food, soil structures is good, nutrient cycling is good, and food availability is good. So there's some of the very rare butterflies of Himalaya. This is the yellow solitary butterfly of Western Himalaya. This is the common species of Nandadevi Biosphere Reserves. This is the area of a Great Himalayan National Park and Pin Valley National Park of Himachal Pradesh. We have done the study of indicators. We have done the study of insect when the area is full of the snow. When the snow melts, this is the area, then you will be able to see large number of flowering plant and do the observation of indicators. This is a particular species of plant. It's a blue poppy, queen of Himalayan flowers. In blue poppy, this one varieties of pollinators exist here. The fragrance is very high. The pollinator exists over there, and this is the rarest plant species here. They're feeding large number of pollinators. This is the Karakoram Wildlife Sanctuary of Ladakh area. This is some of the rare butterflies of Trans-Himalaya area. Is the just wait. I will join after 3 o'clock. Come on. I will join 3 o'clock. I'm some other meeting also. I will join 3 o'clock. Yeah, I'll join 3 o'clock. Yeah. Sorry, I'm other meetings in Nepal on the different issues of biodiversity. Yeah, so this is the area of Ladakh areas of you and some of the real butterflies of Himalayas, Apollos and common butterflies and common birdwing species. The birdwing butterfly look like a bird when the butterfly is flying here. It's very difficult to identify the bird is flying or the butterfly is flying. So this is one of the very high value medicinal plant of Himalayas, orchid species called Dectrolysa heteroxidia. But particular butterflies are schedule one real butterfly feed on this plant. The plant is having high medicinal values and the gentleman doesn't know about it. He is going to the forest and uprooting the plant for medicinal use, but he has killed both ecosystem. He has killed the butterfly and the plant also. So this is a threat for the pollinators, threat of the life of butterflies. This is some of the decorative articles, so rare butterflies and the beautiful butterfly of our countries, like Kesari and Bhutan glory. Some of the panels with of original and artificial butterfly here. From this, in this panel, this lady's hair clips, pasted plastic coated. Inside is the original butterfly here. Yeah, this is a artificial jewelry, butterfly jewelry. It is the lady's earrings, butterfly wings is here. Creative articles, some of the insect estate, and textile industries. Some of the websites, they are selling it in the market also. Some of the potential threat is a grazing, livestock grazing. They are just grazing ground covers, flowers, and when the flowers is gone, the pollinator is gone. Awareness of this. Forest Department, common men, school children, how the number of butterflies in a particular area. Cultural values also. Government is also doing this. Butterflies in Kenya. Aware the common man of the importance of the biodiversity. So even having butterflies here. Mechanism and process for giving the awareness of me. The beetles we're having.
So I think there is problem with the internet. Thank you so much, Kunyal sir. Now we have another lecture from Dr. Avinash Kaur Nagpal. So I will give brief introduction about Professor Avinash Nagpal. I feel privileged to introduce you, Professor Avinash Kaur Nagpal. Her research area is environmental monitoring and genotoxicity, anti-mutagenic and anti-genotoxic potential of medicinal plants, plant tissue culture, plant database, bioinformatics. She has been teaching in the Department of Botanical Environmental Sciences, and her teaching experience is 30 years and research experience is of 38 years. She has published 130 research papers, completed 6 projects, research projects from CSIR, UGC, Punjab government, and supervised 27 PhD students. She has been awarded Biotechnology National Associateship for the year 1995-96 for training at TERI, New Delhi. She has been awarded 3 months overseas training components under Biotechnology National Associateship to have training at National Institute of Biosciences and Human Technology, Japan. She is conferred with Vocational Award 2011, Senior Scientist Award, Lifetime Achievement Awards from various academic and non-academic bodies. Former Dean, Faculty of Life Sciences, Guru Nanak Dev University, former Director, Capacity Enhancement Program, Guru Nanak Dev University. With this brief introduction, I invite Professor Avinash Kaur Nagpal to give her presentation on plant diversity. Dr. Avinash Kaur Nagpal, please.
Thank you, Doctor. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Rajinder, for the nice introduction. And we all have gathered here to celebrate World Environment Day. And the aim is to create awareness on this day. The present talk would be on digital documentation of plant resources. And as we know that the plants are an important component of environment, and we need to conserve them and we need to know them. And then we need to, since we are living in an era of digitization, so we need to digitize these plant resources. So the whole world is celebrating World Environment Day, and the aim is to create awareness for the protection of environment. And we know the present status of environment. The air we breathe, the food we eat, and the water we drink are all polluted with various kinds of toxins. And who is responsible? We all. We, the single species among billions, innumerable species, many we have not yet been able to identify. The present scenario of our environment is the result of our actions, our greed, our unending desires to control everything around us, the flora, the fauna, and the environment. Our population explosion has resulted in rapid strides, so we can say exponential increase in urbanization, industrialization, excessive use of automobiles, ever-increasing air traffic, and the list is never-ending, and which has caused havoc to our environment. And these are some of the pictures showing the industries polluting and the urbanization, and you can see the deforestation. This is the lower side, there are picture of the Mall of Shimla. You can see that how much area of forest have been cut to give place for our residences, for our entertainment places. So theme for this year's World Environment Day is biodiversity, and biodiversity is our most valuable resource, but it is least appreciated by us. When we say biodiversity, it means millions of plant and animal species, different kinds of microbes, and the genetic diversity within each species. And there's interdependence among these species coming from wide range of broader groups. And Professor Unyal has very nicely explained the interactions among different kinds of species and their dependence on each other. Plant diversity is important for sustainable existence of all life forms on this earth, and it is so important that removal of even a single species can upset the balance in the ecosystem, threatening all forms of life within it. Unfortunately, we are instrumental in extinction of different species, even those which we have not yet been able to identify. Population explosion, industrialization, urbanization, and habitat destruction. All these have disturbed the balance within which human operates, threatening the welfare of all living beings, including plants and animals, resulting in their extinction. We have a cultural and moral obligation, as well as a pragmatic economic need, to conserve the diversity of life with which we share the planet. We also need to assess the current state of knowledge and understanding of biodiversity of different regions of the world. I think since 1800s, we are compiling information on plant diversity of different parts of the world in different floras, books, monuments, etc. And since we are living in an era of digitization, this is an era of globalization of information, and of globalization of biodiversity related information is also very well recognized. Proper documentation of our genetic wealth has become an essential component of the study of plants. It is possible by creation of digital databases of biodiversity of different regions of the world. Plant databases, they allow storage and efficient retrieval of information on plant diversity to any user who has a computer and can go online. Plant databases, they also include images or pictures of different parts of the plants, which is an invaluable resource for correct identification of plants. Digitization of information about biodiversity is necessary for easy record keeping of biodiversity related information, to make information easily accessible, and to avoid duplication of efforts by scientists. Some of the efforts at international level include the websites of Botanical Gardens Conservation International at Kew Gardens, European Network for Biodiversity Information, Global Taxonomy Initiative, Consortium, European Taxonomic Facilities, etc. Some of the efforts at national level include eFlora of India by Botanical Survey of India, Flowers of India is in private concern, Srishti, which is from the Society of Research and Initiatives for Sustainable Technologies and Institutions. We at the Department of Botanical and Environmental Sciences, DNDU, have made a humble beginning to digitize text and multimedia information on plants of Punjab. To begin with, we are compiling information on plants of Amritsar. So we have created a digital database, which is known as eDOPS. A database is actually a collection of related data stored in one or more computerized files in a manner that can be accessed by users or computer programs by a database management system. So we need hardware, software, and information on the data for preparing a database. To prepare a database, we need to create the database structure. We need to collect information which we want to store in the database, and then we need to enter the data in a particular format. The database structure was prepared for entry of different fields for different plants. We used the Microsoft Visual Studio 2010 and SQL Server. The information in the database is organized in a series of tables, which are created to store, manage, analyze, and retrieve information regarding plant diversity of the region. For storage of information of plants, the plant entry forms are prepared, which have different fields. For collection of data, different plants, whether they are trees, shrubs, or herbs, they were identified on the basis of their vegetative and reproductive characters. And by comparing them with the herbarium specimens of the department of the herbaria of Punjabi University, Patiala, Punjab University, Chandigarh, Forest Research Institute and Botanical Survey India at Dehradun, and consultation of floras of the region. Information regarding vegetative as well as reproductive characters of each plant was compiled, and photographs of different parts of the plant, so different views of the plant. It's the full view or full plant, a twig, a leaf, an inflorescence, a flower, a fruit, as well as the seeds were taken, and they are stored as HTML files, and they are entered into the database. So to have access from to the eDOPS, we can go to our Guru Nanak University website, and from the university links, and there's a drop-down menu, and from the drop-down menu, we can click on eDOPS. And clicking on eDOPS can take us to this page, which says that it is an electronic database of plants and being created by us at Department of Botanical and Environmental Sciences. It has three sub-databases, eDOTS, which is a database of trees and shrubs, eDOHOP, which is a database of herbaceous plants, and eGNDUH, which is a database or collection of herbarium specimens which are housed in the herbarium of our department. If we want to enter information, and this is accessible only to the person who has the administrative rights, and the person with the administrative rights can log in, and this screen is there. That means after we log in, we can add information about any new plant. When we click on the add new plant, this plant entry form appears. Then we can add information of that plant. We give the information about its botanical name, regarding its genus, species, as well as the authority, its popular names, its family name. So we can look at whether the particular family to which the plant belongs, it is available in the database. If not, then we can add a new family. And then after adding the new family, we can enter information to that family. So we also add its flowering time, its fruiting time, the distribution of the plant in India and abroad, gardening notes, its economic importance, its habit, information about it, its root, and this is about stem, leaf, inflorescence, and all the details of the plants are added, and then we can save. So after we have saved the information about the plant, we later on come to know that some information is incorrect, and then we have the chance to modify by clicking on modify plant details. We are given this screen, and we can always modify whatever information we want to modify. For any user who wants to access the database, one has to log in, and before login, one has to register. Clicking on register, you need to enter your complete details about your name, designation, email, and address, your country, and the PIN code. And clicking on register, you are registered to the database. And after registration, then you need to log in. And after you log in, you have access to this database. For example, here we want to access the database of trees and shrubs. This is E stands for electronic database of trees and shrubs. And here we have compiled information about our botanical garden, as well as about the trees and shrubs of Amritsar city. And we will keep on adding new species. Nearly more than 100 species have already been added, but more species will be added in due course of time. So we click here to see the detailed plants which are available in our botanical gardens. And we can see here that by clicking on this arrow, it gives us a drop-down menu, and we can select any plant, and then we click on its details, and it gives us the detail of that particular species. So this species is Butea monosperma, and its popular names, which is flame of the forest or dark, its family, its nature, it's a tree species, its flowering time is February to April, fruiting time is May to July, its distribution, its gardening notes, and its economic importance is given, and the plant description is given. So all of you can access this information, which is freely available on the database on GNDU website. So then we have also taken the closer view of the inflorescence, the tree bark, its leaves, and a very close view of its leaves and its petiole, where it is attached to the stem, and its inflorescence and different parts of its flower, its calyx, its corolla, androecium, gynoecium, fruits, seeds, and all. So our garden is distributed in different sections because of the laid tiled path. And clicking on that, we have different sections, like we have polypetaly, gamopetaly, we have monoclamidae here, then monocotyledonary, then we have gymnosperms here, we have the arboretum section and the bambusitum section. So clicking on any one of these sections will give us a list of the plants growing in that section, and then we can have access to that those plants. So if we click here on plant wise list, and this gives us the list of plants available in the Amritsar city, and 1818 records have already been added, and more are in pipeline. And clicking on any one of them will give us the detailed information of this plant. That plant, for example, here we have the Abricatorius, which is the Rati plant, and the same details as I explained for the earlier plant can be seen for this particular plant. then we can, if we want to say where, how many plants of a particular family are available in the database, so we can search from the family wise list and clicking on the down arrow, so we can select any one family, and clicking on that family we can select any particular plant, and then we can have detailed information about that plant, searching family wise. Similarly, we have electronic database of herbaceous plants here. This also we can search according to plant wise as well as the family wise. Clicking on the plant wise, we have 61 records available. Clicking on the down arrow, we select any one particular plant. For example, we select here Boravia diffusa. Clicking on its details, we get the details of this particular plant. So this is how it looks like. We are trying to show the each part of the plant. And similarly, we have 25 records for the families, and clicking on the down arrow, we can select any one family, and clicking on the family and the details, we get that we have three plants of this, and then clicking on any one particular plant will take us to the details of that particular plant. So then coming to our third database, that is electronic GNDU herbarium, and this provides information about herbarium specimens which are housed in the Department of Botanical and Environmental Sciences. Nearly 8,000 accessions covering more than 3,000 species of vascular plants have been digitized, and they are available in the database. So we can search eGNDUH by the plant-wise list or family-wise list or location-wise list or collector-wise list or flora-wise list. So clicking on the plant-wise list, we have a 758 records are found, and the records of 758 species, and clicking on the down arrow, we can select any one plant, for example, Eclipha hispida, we have selected, and we have 10 specimens of this species. So we have 10 accessions for one particular species, and this comes from family Euphorbiaceae, and we have the accession number, we have the date of accession, we have the collection number, and we have the collection date. So you see that the collection date is different from the accession date, because after collection, this plant has to be processed to make it to a complete herbarium specimen, and then we need to get it verified from Botanical Survey of India, then only it is entered into the herbarium. And the location from where the plant is collected, and the collector's name, the person who collected this plant, and the flora, which part of India this plant belongs to, and this is the information about this plant. Clicking on any one of this accession will take us to the herbarium sheet of that particular plant. This is a herbarium sheet of this plant, Eclipha hispida, and this is the details of this plant which is on this list. So we can also select how many species of a particular family are there, and you can see clicking on the down arrow, we're selecting any one family, we go to Apocynaceae, and we have 12 species, record of 12 species are there. And clicking on any one of these, like we selected here Elstonia scholaris, and we have 12 records, and we can have all those details, and clicking on any one accession, we can get the information of that particular plant. And similarly, location, we can see that we want to see how many specimens are there from Amritsar. We see there we have 103 specimens from Amritsar. Clicking on any other place, like we have for Dalhousie, we see that we have 373 specimens from Dalhousie, and clicking on any one of the accession will take us to the details of that particular herbarium sheet and its label information. So this is the label information for Conyza stricta, which comes from Dalhousie, and this is how the plant looks like. And then we can also search for example, here it is again by location name. For Gujarat, we have 59 specimens. And this is a specimen from Gujarat Botanical Garden, MS University, Vadodara. And this specimen was collected by me when we went for an educational trip in 2000. Then we have, we can also search the plants, number of plants collected by any collector, and here I'm showing the number of specimens which have been collected by me, 218 specimens. They are the older one, and many more specimens have now been added. And so this is a list of those plants. And then we have 215 specimens collected by Professor Tukral, and 147 specimens collected by Professor Grover. And you can see these specimens. Clicking on any one specimen, we can have the herbarium sheet as well as its label information. So from the plant name, we have we can see the plants. Then we have, when we are showing the economic importance of particular trees or shrubs or herbs, then we are using some medical terms. And glossary of medical terminology can also be seen by clicking on the glossary. And then when we click here on DOBS, the information related to our department is visible. And then clicking on, this is the department information. So there is a feedback form also. So you are most welcome to give feedback, and it is very important for improving the database. And this is the team. Myself, then we have engineer Bhupinder Pal Singh, who's a senior programmer. The botanical information has been compiled under my supervision, whereas the creation of the database has been supervised by engineer Bhupinder Pal Singh. Two of my students have contributed to this database. Gurveen Kaur, she did her PhD on trees and shrubs. Harpreet Kaur, she did her PhD on herbaceous plants. Thank you very much for patient hearing. And
thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am, for this wonderful lecture. And I think participants should visit our botanical garden, a beautiful garden just near to the Vice Chancellor's office of our university. And thank you so much. Now we have Professor Renu Bhardwaj. I request Professor Renu Bhardwaj, Director Search, Dean Faculty of Life Sciences, former Controller Examination of University, to please address the participants on the eve of World Environment Day. Professor Renu Bhardwaj, please.
Thank you, Dr. Rajendra, for a nice introduction. And I must congratulate you for taking up a great initiative on the eve of World Environment Day, because this becomes more important on part of our department, because our department is the Department of Botanical and Environmental Sciences, and every year we do celebrate the days which are associated with the environment, whether that is the Ozone Day, Wetland Day, or World Environment Day. As it has been pointed out by various resource persons, that today is the day when we have to realize the importance of environment, the importance of planet Earth, and its diverse forms in which it is manifesting. We know that nature is huge, nature is astonishing, nature is wonderful, and it is there for in expressing itself in so huge and at large scale that one is really thrilled to see it. But again, unfortunately, instead of respecting it and having a gratitude for the nature, for its natural resources and its various biodiverse forms, we had been exploiting it. And that exploitation, as Avinash Madam had pointed out rightly, that must not be with the need, but because of the greeds. So man's greeds have no bounds, and they have totally disturbed the natural environments, the natural diverse forms, for its petty interests which carry no value. So we have devastated, we had played havoc with the environment, and certainly at every level, whether that is at the planet Earth's sound quality, air quality, water quality, or resources, forestry, wetlands, all we have played havoc. And these are alarming situations, because today is the time of when we say that there's global warming, there is a huge release of carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, greenhouse gases, then so many devastations which are associated with the adverse shape of this planet Earth. And today is the day when we have to realize that what havoc we had played and how to rejuvenate it. Nature has its own ways of rejuvenation. We had seen in the pandemic period, when every activity was at standstill, nature was healing it, itself. Nature was rejuvenating itself. There was so clear sky, there was so clear air, there was so transparency, and the waters were so clean, the wildlife was so safe, and they were enjoying their habitats. So this is what we have to do for nature. And when we say that United Nations Environmental Protection Agency, they had said that when we say climate is changing, it's not climate who is changing, but climate is being destroyed. Because these are the signs. The changing climate is giving a sign that we had to take care of the sound quality of the climate. And these are the signals which is telling human, and human is a custodian of all living forms. Human's responsibility is to take care of life of every plant, every animal, every microbe, whether that is visible or non-visible. Maybe a single bacteria which is residing in a soil could be contributing, doing huge work for us. We know nitrogen fixation bacteria that is hardly to be seen with the naked eye, but they are fixing atmospheric nitrogen. They're getting it converted to nitrates and then making them available. Through food, we are able to take up nitrogen. Otherwise, there's no means whereby we take nitrogen directly from air. So every component of the nature is contributing. They are well connected. They are interdependent. And exploitation of any or extinction of any at any stage will produce huge gap, which could not be repaired and have adverse effect on the entire ecological chain. So this is what we have to take care of. And on this day, when we are celebrating different aspects of, we are discussing different aspects of environment, its preservation programs, its preservation programs, we must commit ourselves that at least at an individual level, I shall be doing activities, whether sitting at my home or in my institution or in my village or in my city, at least I have to make the quality sustainable, so that whatever quality of the environment I imbibed, I was given from my elders who had made a sound quality of the environment, I have to pass it on for the future generations. And this is my responsibility to sustain it further. So with this, I think we should all commit with ourselves that we have to preserve the environment for our own survival. So with this, I thank you all and congratulate you and wish all the success for the completion of this event. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for kind words. Now, there is time for question answer session. And if you have any question, you can ask by raising hand. Participants, if you have any question, you can ask by raising hand. Or you can have questions in chat box. Now I request the participants, if you have any question, you can write in chat box or you can raise the hand. No questions.
Ma'am, I see one hand raised by Amanpreet Kaur.
Okay. Amanpreet Kaur, Abhijit, kindly connect to Amanpreet Kaur.
I think that was by mistake. She just lowered her hand.
Okay, now we...
Ma'am, there's one
question. Meantime, we can have a feedback from our participants. Abhijit?
Ma'am, there's one question from Srinivasan Lakshmi Narayanan in chat window.
Okay. Madam Bindiya, you go ahead with the question.
Okay, ma'am, I'll unmute Srinivasan. I request Srinivasan to kindly introduce himself and ask the question.
Hi.
I've unmuted Srinivasan now.
Hello. Very good afternoon. It was such a wonderful session. I'm from Bangalore. And my question is about this. It's a wonderful session. I had a chance to listen on biodiversity and the documenting the various plant species. On this World Environment Day, my question is do you have from the professors any suggestions on completely migrating from the chemical fertilizers, pesticides to the complete organic solutions for the entire the plant diversity that we have, whether it's an apartment gardens or it's a lakes or any flora and fauna? Is there any plan or suggestions to avoid the chemical NPK or chemical solutions, which will again spoil the soil's micronutrients and completely go towards the organic solutions? Any suggestions would be welcome from the professors. Thank you.
I think this answer can be given by Professor Avinash Kaur Nagpal. Ma'am, please. Professor Avinash Kaur Nagpal.
Yes, Srinivasan, I think we need to go back to the earlier ways of farming. We need to cut down the chemical fertilizers as well as pesticides. We need to go for the organic ways of farming. If at all, when we are going to shift from chemical to the purely organic, so let's start doing it less chemical and more of organic, and ultimately, phase-wise, we can ultimately we eliminate all the chemicals. Definitely, we need to go, and the more we are away from the nature, more we are causing harm to the environment. This is a time each one of us have to think. And even smallest of the thoughts can lead to a small action. But if these small action by each one of us taken with conscience can do wonders. But let us not point fingers to anybody else. Let us introspect. Let us think the way we live our lives. Let us change the way we live our lives so that we create an environment which does not need protection. We have to be very careful. We have to be very conscious of our actions so that we try to keep our environment safe and green. Thank you.
There is one question from, he's asking that how we can grow a medicinal plant at home during this COVID season.
Number of videos are coming
up. This question is from Ravi Kant Anand.
Number of videos are coming up these days, and you can grow plants in plastic boxes and or in wooden boxes, and even soilless growing is there, and we are talking about microgreens as well. So if you have a will, you have the way. You'll find a way to go for it.
Ma'am, there are two more questions. One by Anant Yu. His question is how to conserve the wildlife animals in this modern world.
Let us not disturb, let us not interfere in the ecosystem. Let us keep ourselves away. Let us make our niche and then let it be. the less we interfere, the better it is. Conscious thoughts, conscious actions are needed.
There is one more question. Ma'am, what do you say about this conversation of biological wealth into economical wealth?
Biological wealth is economical wealth. The plants are the biggest resource for the food we eat, for the fiber, for accommodation, for our medicines, for our dyes, for our rubber, name anything. All resources, most 90% of the resources, they come from plants. So they are the biggest economy, economical resource.
There is one more question. How we can conserve our biodiversity without paying attention to environmental issues?
If we conserve biodiversity, environmental issues will automatically get resolved. And plant diversity conserved, and then we have the habitat for the animals becomes conserved, which is then the environment would be green and safe environment, clean and green environment. Environment and biodiversity are interrelated. Biodiversity is a very important component of the environment.
Now, question from Srinivasan. Is there any distance master degree program or online MOOC program from Guru Nanak University on ecology and environmental science?
At present, we don't have. We may think of.
Okay. So I think these are the questions. Now we can have feedback. For feedback, Abhijit, kindly unmute Dr. Rajni Khanna. Abhijit? Abhijit, can you see Dr. Rajni Khanna? Dr. Jaswinder Kaur?
Yes, ma'am.
Anyone who want to give feedback for the conference? Any participant?
Abhijit has some internet issues. I can unmute the concerned person. I don't see, what was the first name? Sorry, you said?
Dr. Jaswinder Kaur, Dr. Rajni Khanna.
Okay, ma'am, I'll just see if I can.
Hello.
Yes.
Am I audible?
Rajni Khanna is there, yes.
Hello.
Okay. Yes, ma'am, yes, you are audible.
It was wonderful session, elaborative, knowledgeable, what else? It was really wonderful. Thank you so much. Thank you, Guru Nanak Dev University and Department of Botanical and Environmental Sciences. Congratulations to you all. This has really added a lot in our knowledge. Thank you so much. And a very happy World Environment Day to you all. Let's all join hands to make this earth beautiful place to live with flora and fauna. Thank you and Jai Hind.
Jai Hind. Achha. Now, Abhijit, connect any student who can give feedback.
Ma'am, there are a number of feedback in the chat window. I mean, everyone is
pleased. Oh, okay.
So can I unmute?
Okay.
I would like to unmute Amita Mahajan. Dr. Amita, I'm unmuting you. There is some problem at her end.
Okay. So then we can come to our...
This Vinder Kaur, I do see. Shall I unmute her?
Yes.
Okay.
Hello. Am I audible, please?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Yes, very good afternoon to all of you.
It was really wonderful session, and we are really glad to know that everyone is thinking about the conservation of biodiversity. These are really very good efforts. Congratulations to the organizers, and great salute to my all the teachers who are doing so great efforts to conserve the environment. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Now we can have a vote of thanks from our coordinator, Professor Saroj Arora. I invite Professor Saroj Arora to thank the audience as well as our speaker. Professor Saroj Arora, please. She is the coordinator of the webinar on this biodiversity. Professor Saroj Arora, please. Abhijit, kindly connect Professor Saroj Arora. Hello.
So good evening all. Can you hear me? Hello.
Yes, ma'am, we can hear you.
Yeah. So good evening all. On behalf of the Department of Botanical and Environmental Sciences and as well as the members of coordinating committee, so I take the opportunity to propose vote of thanks to all concerned. At the outset, I thank our chief guest and the keynote speaker, Dr. Oman V. Oman, and other invited resource persons, Professor Unyal and Professor Avinash Nagpal. We are really enlightened with your knowledge and presentations and the presence, as well as sparing your valuable time. Special thanks are to the faculty of the department for their unflinching support and coordination. My heartfelt thanks to our students, research scholars of the department, university from other universities of India, colleges, as well as from outside India also, which we can see that people are participating in this. And your enthusiastic participation has really given motivation to all of us. I have no words to thank Dr. Rajinder Kaur, Associate Professor of the Department of Botanical and Environmental Sciences, for her untiring efforts in organizing this seminar. She has contacted all the source persons, chalked out the program, created the Zoom platform with the help of Mr. Abhijit Singh from the Physics Department, Madam Bindia, faculty member of our own university, Department of Physics. I'm really thankful to you. And I congratulate Dr. Jinder for this successful conducting this webinar very successfully, and really appreciate her efforts. And I'm really thankful to Professor Renu Bhardwaj for giving very beautiful comments on this webinar and guiding the students and research scholars and all the concerned to conserve the environment. Last but not least, I am really thankful to our authorities, Professor Jaspal Singh Sandhu, Vice Chancellor of the university, and other authorities in the university for giving us the platform to organize this webinar, and head of the department, Dr. Manpreet Singh Bhatti, for giving the welcome address. And all the logistic support has been given by the university. I'm really thankful. So with these warm words and kind message, we move to the end of the today's webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you much. Thank you very much, all the participants and speakers. So we will end the meeting. Abhijit,